Today's kit build is assisted by Pioneer Harvest Stout from Farmery Brewing in Nipawa, Manitoba. They actually brew their beer right on the farm where the barley and hops is grown. Very cool story. So today I'm building this simple little kit that I got in a mailbag a few weeks ago. This was something that an anonymous donor sent into the channel. And impressive compared to some of these cheap Chinese kits, it actually came with a schematic. Which is really kind of nice because that means I don't have to draw one. At the heart of this is a CD4511 chip, which is a BCD, binary coded decimal, to 7-segment LED driver chip. And then we have a 7-segment LED, of course, what else would you have? For some reason, a transistor over here driving the cathode, the common cathode of the LED. Over here we have power coming in. We have the input to it, which is basically just a single pin or single input on pins 2 and 3 there, going through that resistor to the base of this transistor and driving some of the BCD lines over here. As far as I can tell, what it does is either generates an L or an H on the 7-segment display, depending on whether this input is a binary high or a binary low. It's a logic probe. There's lots of different ways of doing this, but this is the way that they've decided to implement it. You may be wondering how they get a letter H and a letter L out of that. Well, you notice that the segment outputs don't necessarily go to where you would expect them to go based on the datasheet. Segment A output doesn't go anywhere at all. And segment A is that top segment horizontally there. You don't need that for either an H or an L, so they're not even using it. Segment B output goes to segment D. So segment B is actually this side, but D is down here across the bottom, which presumably is only used for the L. Segment C doesn't go anywhere. Segment D output goes to both B and C, which are these two over here. So that, I guess, is needed for the H. The L, I'm assuming, is going to need these two. Anyway, it does that all the way along. They don't line up the way you'd expect them to, and a couple of them are doubled up and a couple of them are missing. So it should be interesting to see this thing in operation. Now, logic probe, for those who haven't seen them, is basically a tool to do just what you said, what I said there, show the state of a digital circuit, either high, whether it's a binary high or a binary low. For troubleshooting older discrete digital circuits, it's not a bad tool to have around. I mean, you could use a meter too, but why not use a purpose-built tool if you've got one? A lot of these cheap kits have the component value marked on the board. This one doesn't. It has the designation R3, R4, R6, etc. And that means I'm going to have to keep the parts list handy, which came with it. Which is really nice, really convenient that it actually came with the parts list too. Right, let's get our components dumped out and get the board holder in. Which as usual is going to be this guy. It may not be the best one in the world, but I like it. It does the job. I don't know. Do you have your preference for other types? I do have a few others around here, but this just happens to be the one that I keep going back to. So as is my typical method, I'm going to start with the components that are physically the smallest, lowest profile, and least likely to be damaged by subsequent ham-fistedness, which is almost always the resistors followed by ceramic capacitors, then any sockets and whatnot, and then the other components in whatever order fits physically the best. And just for funsies, I'll follow them in component designation order. So R1 is a 2K, and there's only one of them. And that is that one. I'm not trusting my eyes on the color bands for two important reasons. First, they're really hard to read on these bluey kind of resistor bodies. And two, I'm colorblind. So R1 lives down here. And I think I'm going to put a few of these resistors in before I decide to solder them down. R2 and 3 are 1 meg, and it's the only resistor that there's two of. And conveniently, they're both taped together. Should I trust them? Yes, I think I shall. I'll probably get burned on it at some point, but let's go for it. R2 and R3. R2 is up there, and R3 is up here just beside it. Next, R4 is 120K, which is that one. R5 is a 1K, that one. R6 is 10K. There we go. Close enough anyway. Which means the last resistor remaining should be R7, which should be 51 ohms. Success. Close enough. And then make sure those guys are all bent over so they don't drop out when I flip the board over completely here. And let the soldering commence. I seem to have created a forest for myself to work around. Not ideal. Oh well. Just poke along at it here. Shouldn't be a big problem. These leads bend out of the way. I am giving my iron a bit of a clean after every couple of joins just to get the flux build up off the iron and any excess solder and oxidization and whatnot. I'm alternating between using the old school sponge and the newer style brass shavings thing. They both work. It's preference. I don't really have a preference one way or another. As long as you clean it, because that tip just works so much better when it's clean. You get a good transfer of heat. Make a nice quick join. Here's where I'm kind of getting in my own way for having all these resistors in here at the same time. But I was able to work around it. And give the board a quick haircut and carry on with probably the ceramic capacitors. Then the electrolytics and then what, diodes and transistors, I guess, after that. And last, the chip, because this kit didn't come with a socket for the chip. So our three capacitors, C1 and C3, are ceramic. C2 is a 10 microfarad electrolytic. And there are those two ceramic capacitors, which match what the kit calls for. That's always nice. Well, C1 is the 221. And C3 is the 473. Where are you down there? As always, the electrolytic capacitors are polarized. The negative is marked on the side of the can. The long lead is positive, and on the board, it's marked as well. It's the negative side and the positive side right there. Can I get at that with my board holder in the way? Yep. So next, I think I'll do these pin headers over here for the inputs. They aren't all that critical, but they are unlikely to get damaged and they're not going to be in the way. You can also grab the chunk of blue tack here to hold onto the thing so that it doesn't fall out and I don't burn my fingers while I'm soldering it on. Just changed up how the board's being held here so that it's not taking up as much real estate and getting in my way. And I think I will put the power wires on, again, for the same logic. They're not going to be in my way, and I'm starting to run out of things that won't be damaged by soldering and heat and other abuses, so I'll just get those out of the way. Normally I would want to leave those to last just because they're not that important and they might get in the way, but in this case I don't think they will be in my way. All right, it's all semiconductors left. I think I'll put that LED in, just a single indicator LED. This guy down here, which just goes through a 1K resistor between the two power rails. LED is another polarized component. Notice that flat side on there that indicates the negative, as well as the shorter lead indicates the negative. And in this case on the board, we just have a diode symbol. The positive side is that end of the diode, the negative is down there. I guess let's grab this diode next. It's another polarized component, the band showing the negative end of it, and the band on the silk screen showing the same thing. I'll put the big LED in next. It's all semiconductors from here, so I don't think it matters too much from a damage standpoint. Let's get this little peel off of here. Sorry, no music with that one. The LED just drops into its position. Just drops into its position here. And since that fits tightly enough, I don't have to worry about it falling out, but I will use my frequent trick of just soldering one corner down first, flipping it up, putting some pressure on it, remelting that, good, and picking one on the other side, doing the same thing, reach around, push, heat, good. All in place now, and I can go ham on it. Still, when I'm soldering a multi-pin device like this, I like to sort of bounce around. So I'll do one on that corner, and then one over there, and one over here. Clean my iron, let it cool off for a second. One up here. What I'm doing is spreading the heat around so that the whole device doesn't get horribly overheated. That one didn't flow very well. I don't know if it helps or not, but it makes me feel better that, like I said, the heat is being spread around so that it doesn't concentrate and doesn't risk blowing things up quite so badly. Next, we had a couple of transistors, and they are, I believe, the same. Yes, they are. They're just common 9014, which are a very basic NPN transistor. Could probably replace them with just about any NPN transistor and they would work just as well, but these are what they've included, so these are what we shall use. The silkscreen approximates the shape of the package, so that's the way we're going to put it in and hope that it's correct. I prefer if the shape is actually shown as a half oval rather than this little trapezoidy thing, but I'm pretty confident that this is correct. Let's get in here and solder them down. Again, spreading the heat around so that we don't inadvertently blow anything up. Shouldn't be a problem, as I mentioned earlier, but why take the additional risk if you don't have to? And now, the only thing left is the chip. A little disappointed that they cheaped out and didn't send me a socket, but I am going to just go for it anyway. What's the worst that could happen? I blow it up and have to dig into my own stash to see if I've got a spare of this chip. Well then, this is a bit of a pain though, getting all these legs lined up. I'll have to fiddle with it a little bit here, and as I said before, on the LED, I pick one corner, quickly solder it down, get a finger onto the chip on the other side, give it a push and a reheat, pick one on the diagonally opposite corner, same thing, finger around, push, reheat, good. Now that chip is held in there in place, it's not going anywhere, verify that all the pins are still where I want them, and go to town again, bouncing around to spread the heat out. Especially since there's no socket, you want to give yourself a fighting chance of not destroying things. They're not that fragile, but why take the risk if you don't have to? So that's all the soldering. Celebratory drink. So that's connected up to 5 volts. I've got a 50 milliamp current limit on it initially, just in case there's any shorts on there. You don't want to blow it up. Contact. It's only drawing 3 milliamps. and the LED's not lighting. Let's just check and make sure voltage is getting onto the board. Yeah, there's 5 volts there. Okay. 0.7 volts across that LED. That's not enough to light it. Let's see what happens if we put an input onto there. That should be a high. Oh, hey, that works. That should be a low. And that works too. And open gives you nothing. Okay. But why isn't that guy lighting up? So I replaced the LED thinking that maybe it was damaged or something. But that didn't make any difference. But then I got to thinking. I measure a voltage across. And again, it's 0.7 volts. And as I said before, that LED is never going to light. But then I put my thinking brain on and looked at the schematic again. And that LED is in parallel with the base emitter junction of this transistor. And the base emitter junction, the voltage drop across that transistor is going to be 0.7 volts, which is going to clamp it, which means this LED can never light. So that's just chasing my tail and wasting time. Well, I hope I remember that and learn something from it. But the rest of the circuit does work as advertised. There is a low and there is a high. Let's try this out on a real circuit, just for the fun of it. So here is an old favorite circuit that I keep built up on a breadboard just because I like going back to it. 555 timer, CD4017 decade counter, handful of resistors and capacitors. It's just your basic 10-step chase light. And if we go on to, let's say, pin 3 of the 555, you can see it bouncing between high and low as it toggles itself. And if we go on to one of the LED outputs over here, you can see that these are tri-state outputs. They only go high when they're called high, and when they're not in use or when they're not being called for, they go to an open circuit state or a high resistance state. We could use just a normal LED with a resistor to tell us things, but that will only tell us if there's voltage presence or not. That won't tell us if it's a voltage presence or, well, a binary high or a binary low, or, as this one shows, a high impedance state. Neat little circuit. Kind of unorthodox the way they're driving that, but very cool nonetheless, and well worth putting together. And I learned something in my troubleshooting. Again, I'm probably just being too hasty while I'm doing the video, thinking about too many things and not thinking about what I should. The obvious things in the circuit are things that should be obvious to somebody that's got some experience. Anyway, I hope that was entertaining or interesting or informative or any of the above. Thanks for watching. Comments and questions down below as usual. And thanks to whoever the anonymous donor is that sent in this kit into my mailbag. Appreciate that. It was fun to build. Thank you, sir. Or ma'am, but probably sir. Talk to you later.